Hello everyone. Welcome to our SAP community call about the future of continuous delivery for SAP Cloud SDK and Cloud Application Programming Model. We have today Florian and Artem from the SAP Cloud SDK development team. Feel free to use the Q&A tab for asking questions or use the chat to also communicate. So please take it away.
Yeah, thanks, Masha. And hello, everyone. My name is Artem, and I'm a product owner of SAP Cloud SDK. And today with us is Florian, who is a lead developer of the Cloud SDK and working on the continuous delivery best practices for the SDK and in SAP globally. So this session will include the future of how we see continuous delivery for both SAP Cloud SDK and Cloud Application Programming Model, which you probably know as CAP. And yeah, let's kick it off. Yeah, just before we start, you should understand that this is a forward-looking statement. That means that you shouldn't make your buying decisions based on this presentation, because it can include some features that still in beta or might not be continued. Yeah, just a usual notice, so be mindful about it. And we start as usual. Yeah, nice, Code Snippet is already here. So we're starting as usual with some updates of what recently happened in the Cloud SDK. And on the Java side, we are actually working to improve some convenience for you. And now you can register your destinations programmatically, which helps a lot with debugging and local development. You can also give them different priority with append destination loader or prepend destination loader to the destination accessor. That is quite convenient. So if you want to have flexibility there, then go and try it. We also went general availability with a workflow API service on the Cloud Foundry. It's quite a popular one. And we publish a REST client for it with all the convenience that SDK has to offer. We also did our regular updates for S/4HANA Cloud and on-premise for the latest releases, 2011 and 2020 respectively. And I can give you an interesting sneak peek on the soon to be released, basically this week, open API generator for Cloud SDK that will basically bring the power of open API specification being converted to a type-safe client for you guys, and then nicely and neatly integrated with all the other Cloud SDK value adds like connectivity authentication, supporting different SAP runtimes within SAP Cloud Platform, and so on. Yeah, that's where those were exciting news about Java. And for those preferring JavaScript for writing the business application extensions, I want to notify that our open source repository migrated to a new Slack, you know, a new space in GitHub. So if you want to find it and get it lost, then this is the correct link. Also, as in Java, we of course commit to our promise and pre-generate for you libraries for all the S/4HANA offering cloud and on-premise. Like, it's nice to get it out of the box from the NPM, despite of course for all the custom services you can generate it yourself using a data generator. Also, we've listened for you, and for some it was not easy to use our filter methods, taking REST parameters for the functions as actually REST parameters, and that array is more usual practice for that. So we introduced support for arrays as well. Yeah, also the batch request is now GA in Odata V4, and we updated documentation for function imports and actions, action imports, including some edge cases that we have identified, so that you are not getting into troubles and knowing where to look for solutions. And also, I would remind you that all the recent updates and cutting edge features that we released, you can always find in our documentation. Just take a quick look every time you have a chance or looking for a solution. You have convenient quick links. You can use quick search for basically finding anything with typing just a couple of letters. Also, just use the menu and feel yourself comfortable with basically this is the function imports, and here you can see how easily you can get started with the scenarios just by copying code snippets. And please also let us track you. I understand we are in Germany, at least this session. I'm running from Germany, and privacy is taken seriously here, so the tracking is fully anonymous. But I encourage you to allow us to track, to make the documentation better for you. This way we can understand what is most interesting in the SDK, and maybe extend documentation on those topics and provide you with more valuable content. And that was a quick update. I hope you liked it. And now I introduce the agenda for our session. That would be quite interesting, because you might have noticed that SDK has lost one of the components that you might have got used to. It's SDK, it's a continuous delivery toolkit, or SDK for continuous delivery. But we haven't actually lost it. It just became more powerful, but in a different way. And today, Florian, who is often speaker for the Cloud SDK in different conferences about continuous delivery best practices, will guide us through the future of the continuous delivery offering, which we still hope you will use out of the box with the Cloud SDK. Then he'll run a demo. Of course, we are all developers here, so we don't trust only words. And we are happy to hear your feedback in the Q&A session afterwards. And now I'm giving it over to Florian.
All right, thank you, Artem. I quickly share my screen. Choose the right desktop to share. All right, perfect. Okay, I trust that you can see the right screen. It should be the full screen PowerPoint presentation. All right, hi from me too. My name is Florian, and as introduced, I'm a developer at SAP in the SAP Cloud SDK team, and specifically I'm working for on continuous delivery. The SAP Cloud SDK has a component about making it easier for you to get started with continuous delivery, and the current state and the future of this is exactly what this talk is about. So I spent the last about 3 years of my working life working on this in a team of about 4 developers, and we're located in Potsdam, and if you're interested, much of what we're doing is open source, so can also find me on GitHub, of course. Okay, a look back, how did it really start? This is just really meant to be a really quick overview. So probably many of you have not heard of SAP RealSpend, I assume. So RealSpend is an application, and it's about budget management for managers, so they can see the different cost centers and all that. But what it does is now not really interesting, but interesting is the way that it was developed. So it makes use of existing SAP solutions such as SAP S/4HANA, but it's not an integral part of SAP S/4HANA. It adds additional functionality on top of S/4HANA, and it also works in a different way. So this is, it works in a way that we would call cloud native. So I think you have an image in your head if I say this. So the typical kind of cloud software as a service that you might use, you expect different capabilities of it. Like you expect it to be always available. You expect it to be updated frequently. You don't expect to have like waiting half a year for a release and then having a lot of changes at once, but having releases quite often and getting new features quite regularly. And this is what SAP Rearspend provided a few years ago when it was not really that common, at least at SAP. And this is where Rearspend was a project that inspired teams within SAP that said, oh, this is really interesting. How can I do this? I'm interested in doing something similar. And this is how the SAP Cloud SDK was born. Essentially, the Cloud SDK, the goal was to rip out those parts of Rearspend that are really not specific to Rearspend, but to be able to share them with different teams. And so where the components created that Artem just mentioned. So the original component is the SAP Cloud SDK for Java. Rearspend is written in Java, at least on the backend side. And SAP Cloud SDK for Java essentially were the parts of Rearspend that helped you deliver those qualities and are reusable. So it's used within SAP, but it's also available for external customers and partners who are interested in building cloud native applications. And it helps you with that part, with communicating with the backend systems, with resiliency, with all that things that a cloud application nowadays needs. There is also a JavaScript version. So we are talking here essentially JavaScript on the backend, Node.js. So that is implemented in TypeScript. It's for JavaScript and TypeScript applications, and it aims to fulfill a similar promise as the Cloud SDK for Java. And there has been the continuous delivery component. So the continuous delivery component started out as a codified Jenkins pipeline. If you're a bit familiar with Jenkins, you might know that in the old days, you usually clicked your Jenkins jobs for doing your continuous delivery jobs. And then there have been options to export them as XML and import them in a different system, but that does not really scale well. And what we found that there was really a need, people asked, oh, you're doing continuous delivery. Okay, cool. But what about all those requirements that we need to fulfill? So at SAP specifically, there is a process for how to release software to ensure different qualities, like which libraries are you using? Are they in some way problematic, be it license or be it security, things like that. So there are many things that you need to do. And the basic idea with the continuous delivery toolkit was to automate this process as far as possible. So to get a balance of being able to release often, not having many manual steps involved, but also being able to do it automatically. And the Cloud SDK for continuous delivery was open sourced in the beginning. So it's an open source project, and there are variations of it for internal users, because at SAP internally, there are some requirements that of course don't really make sense for externals. So this is how we got started with that. To give you just a really brief overview. So how does it fit together? You probably in the SAP ecosystem want to interact with some of those solutions that are listed here on the left. So this might be S4HANA or any of the others that is listed. And you might want to have an application that does this integration if your solution has a certain complexity. And the SAP Cloud SDK helps you doing that. I mean, you can, of course, also do it without the Cloud SDK, but it provides a lot of benefits. It makes it more convenient to use. And the Continuous Delivery Toolkit was a bit orthogonal part for making it easier to get started with continuous delivery. This is also what we learned when speaking with customers and partners in the SAP ecosystem. Many of them have heard about continuous delivery and are interested in it, but also many tell us, oh yeah, it's a bit complex. We're not really sure. We're looking for best practices, how to get started. And that's what we're here to help you for. You might also have heard of the SAP Cloud Platform Continuous Integration and Delivery. So that's a service that is part of SAP Cloud Platform. And that also is available not for so long. So I don't exactly remember when it started. But this is something where you get a version of the pipeline really as a service. So as opposed to having to host your own infrastructure, I mean, of course, some people prefer hosting their own infrastructure, but in some cases, it's also people have asked, okay, can we get this as a service? Can you do this for us? There's Cloud Platform. Cannot Cloud Platform help us doing continuous delivery? And this is what the service can do for you. And you might have already seen in the picture before, there was this ominous Project Piper. And I'm not really sure how many of you know this already, so I'll also quickly introduce Project Piper. So the goal of Project Piper is to offer continuous integration related tooling for the SAP ecosystem specifically. So we know that many customers and partners have quite complex infrastructures, and we want to help them fulfilling the needs that they or their customers have with specific applications. And we are convinced that continuous delivery is the right way to approach this. So also being able to deploy applications to the cloud platform. So Project Piper is based on learnings in internal teams at SAP and also working with customers and partners. So it combines different views, different angles that we look at the project. And it started out as a Jenkins library. So that's what I just mentioned. I mean, in the old days, you used to configure your jobs in the user interface and maybe export them as XML, but Jenkins introduced a few years ago a version where you have a domain-specific language where you can write your pipeline as code, and this can also be shared. And this is what Project Piper started SAP internally for teams asking, okay, how can I do this? What are the best practices? What do I need to do? And also in the interaction with customers and partners. It also provides Docker images. I mean, that's maybe not too exciting, but the basic idea here is just to help people to get started quickly. So it also provides a Jenkins image that already has all the plugins that the pipelines need. So it just works well together. And it started out as you can imagine it like a set of Lego boxes where you can pick the pieces. So that is the library part. So you get individual functions, individual steps, as it's called in Jenkins, and you can take them and put them together to build your own pipeline. But it also, Project Piper also then introduced ready-made pipelines. So those are pipelines where you don't have to build it yourself. So, but there is an offering, a ready-made pipeline, and you can see, okay, does it fit my requirements? If yes, then you can use it. If not, then you can still take the Lego blocks and build your own pipeline. That's essentially what this means. And also recently, that's a new development in this year. It also provides a command line tool. So that's written in Go, which maybe for if you're just using this is not really interesting, but it's also open source. And you can, we re-implemented the steps where we saw value beyond of Jenkins users in this command line tool. So that allows you a whole lot of other options. So for example, I mean, that's a command line tool that's available for Linux. You can run it locally if you have a Linux system, but you can also run it other CI/CD hosting solutions. For example, Azure DevOps and GitHub Actions are gaining popularity lately, but you might also use it in some other contexts like Travis CI or Circle CI. I mean, in the end, they work quite similar. So this is a way of how you can also implement a pipeline outside of Jenkins, if that is what you're interested in. So this is Project Piper is built by many contributors internally from SAP, but also external of SAP. As I mentioned, it's an open source project. And the Cloud SDK team, where I'm working in, contributed quite a lot of features in there. Okay, so, but the issue is that this box question. So if you look at the documentation of Project Piper, then you can see here various points that I mentioned. So I mentioned the library steps. So those are essentially the functions, the Lego blocks that you can take. I mentioned the command line tool. I also mentioned the infrastructure, so the Docker images, and then there is this this point pipeline. And there you can see, okay, there is a ABAP environment pipeline, and there is a general purpose pipeline and SAP Cloud SDK pipeline. And I'm now not talking about the ABAP pipeline because it's actually different, but people were looking at the documentation, they saw the general purpose pipeline and this for the Cloud SDK pipeline, and they quite rightly asked, okay, what is the difference? What should I use? It's not really clear. So let's see how we answer this question. The SAP Cloud SDK pipeline historically has been a different beast from the Piper general purpose pipeline. So I'm sorry, the terms are a bit confusing. So it has been around for, I don't remember exactly, about 3 years, I think. And so it had a quite tight coupling to the SAP Cloud SDK. So the basic idea was, okay, we want to be able for people to get started quickly with the project. So we do provide Maven archetypes. So the basic idea is, if you don't really care too much about individual details, we can provide defaults for you, defaults that should be good, defaults that get you started. So we provide Maven archetypes that have the Cloud SDK and other nice to have dependencies already configured, a proper project structure, and they already include the pipeline. So they already include a Jenkins file to get you started. You can then start your Jenkins instance, and you can set up your continuous delivery pipeline literally in 5 minutes. And I mean, at least for like the smaller configuration, and then you go piece by piece and add more features or configure more features to it. You don't have to write code for them, you can configure them. Project Piper started at around the same time SAP internally, and it later became an open source project for the reasons that I already mentioned. So SAP internal teams had those challenges, but also customers and our colleagues who are working with customers and partners saw the same challenges. And Project Piper then started with a separate pipeline, and they might look quite similar on the if you're just taking it from the documentation. So what is really the difference? And our answer to this so far has been, all right, so either look at this decision tree. So either you're doing a Cloud SDK project, or you're doing a Cloud Application Programming Model, also known as CAP project. So then Cloud SDK pipeline should be the right for you. And if you use something different, so if you use a different programming language, for example, so the general purpose pipeline also supports different languages, it supports building Docker files, but also if you have a Java project that does not really fit what the Cloud SDK pipeline was designed to do, that does not comply with the archetypes that we provide, then maybe general purpose pipeline might be easier for you. So if you're looking at it internally, as I mentioned, the Cloud SDK pipeline started out about 3 years ago. The general purpose pipeline came a bit later, and in the beginning, they were completely different in the implementation that they are. So Steps is now a Jenkins terminology, stage is also, so step is essentially a function. They used different steps, stages, and also higher level concepts. So, I mean, if I'm mentioning concepts here, then I'm talking about things like how does the stashing of files internally work. If you worked with Jenkins before, you might be familiar with Jenkins does stashing between different stages. So pipeline stages might be different, executed on different runners, on different agents. And this has been the situation for quite some time. And people kept asking the question, okay, does it really make sense? I'm a bit confused, what should I do? And what happened a bit in the meantime over the last 2 years was that we saw, oh yeah, I mean, those steps are quite similar. Is it really useful to maintain them in two different projects? No, not really. And so we started contributing steps that we had in the Cloud SDK pipeline to Project Piper, which kind of by definition has a broader scope because it's not really part of the SAP Cloud SDK. And so we used steps that they already had. We contributed our own steps. And so the steps got applicable in a broader context. At some point, you then also asked, okay, I mean, the stages essentially do the same. They work a bit differently. They have a bit different names, but essentially they are there for a similar purpose. Isn't there a way to unify that? And in the end, maybe the hardest part was, okay, they still have a bit different concepts for historical reasons. That does not really make too much sense from a user perspective. So, I mean, is there a way to unify that? And in the end, with some sacrifices, we made it to unify them, which, I mean, essentially, I think you all seen where this leads. In the end, the pipelines really don't have any special purpose. I mean, it does not really make sense to have two pipelines if they're essentially the same. And so this is now the new unified offering. So it's the Project Piper general purpose pipeline. It now gained a lot of more capabilities that have been part of the Cloud SDK pipeline before, but also it's much more flexible. So the Cloud SDK pipeline used to make quite a few assumptions about your project type, about your project structure, and the general purpose pipeline is a bit more flexible by design. And we now did our best to unify those to make it more easy for the user to see what it provides and also to take away friction of trying out different pipelines and what does it really do. So what does this mean if you are a user of the Cloud SDK pipeline? Our recommendation is that projects that are starting new should start with the general purpose pipeline now. So we have updated the documentation and the archetypes for the general purpose for the Cloud SDK archetypes and documentation. All major features are migrated into the general purpose pipeline. So there might still be individual cases where not all features are there, but we made our best to judge how good a feature is used and how much it's liked. I mean, of course, if you notice a feature that is missing, you can create an issue on GitHub. We created a guide that explains how to, I mean, if you are an existing user of the Cloud SDK pipeline, we created a guide that explains how you can make the switch. I will also give you a short demonstration about this in a minute. We do have configuration validation, so that should at least give you some guidance for, I mean, it's essentially the same as the guide, but it's you can enable it in your pipeline so that your pipeline will tell you, okay, this configuration is still the old one, please update. And this also means that existing users of the general purpose pipeline have gotten much more functionality now. So this is, I think, really interesting also for everyone. I mean, that the general purpose pipeline so far mostly was an empty skeleton where you could program your own stages, but now almost all the stages have default implementation that are essentially based on what the Cloud SDK pipeline did before. So there is much, I mean, if you're fine with those defaults, then you don't need to do anything more. If you are an existing user and have your extensions, then you can still use them. Yes, so new issues should then be created in the open source repository of the project Piper. So it's called Jenkins Library for historical reasons. So on github.com/SAP/Jenkins Library, they can create issues if there are questions about this. And in case you're a user of the cloud platform continuous integration and delivery, then this will also be reflected there, as this service as of now is using the Cloud SDK pipeline, but it will be updated. At some point, I cannot give any concrete details here because I still also don't know it, but there is a what's new section specifically for the service, and I can recommend to keep a look on that. Okay, so if you are an existing user and you want to make the switch, I mentioned we have a guide, it's on GitHub in this link. You can also then click it later in the presentations. And essentially the change boils down to two things. So it sounds really simple, right? So the Jenkins file is there. The Jenkins file, if you are familiar with Jenkins 2.0 pipelines, then you will know a Jenkins file. So this is where you then typically write your whole pipeline in a domain-specific language. And the Jenkins file needs to be updated if you're switching from the one pipeline to the other pipeline, because essentially the whole Jenkins file, it's here on the screen twice. So it essentially only says, okay, I need this library and then I want to run this step, which is the pipeline. So this used to be the Cloud SDK pipeline, but now it's the Piper pipeline. So that is the change there. And then you still need to adapt the configuration, because unfortunately, there needed to be breaking changes, so it was not possible to unify the configuration in a non-breaking way. And if you configure this legacy config settings thing right here, then this activates what I just mentioned. So this is an automatic check for your pipeline. This is now just an excerpt of what you might have to configure. So let us just quickly go into that. It's, there's another reference to the full guide. So what are those config settings in here? So first is that you can configure a feature toggle in for a build tool, which the Cloud SDK pipeline used to do by default. So this essentially looks at your project and looks for, so that the pipeline tries to be smart about what type of project is this. Is this a Maven project? Is this an MTA project? Or is this a JavaScript project? And then do the right thing. This is not done automatically in the general purpose pipeline, and for backwards compatibility reasons, we cannot really enable it there by default. So if you still think this is a nice feature, it's still available if you enable it using this toggle. A setting that has been the default in the Cloud SDK pipeline, but is not in the general purpose pipeline, is to do not automatically push Git tags. So the thing that both pipelines automatically do is to create a new version each time you run the pipeline on your productive branch. By default in Git, that's called master, but it can be called anything. And so you can, it creates a version that's based on the timestamp and on the commit ID and on your existing version string. And the basic idea here is that you don't assign a new version each time you do a release, because a release can happen automatically if you're doing continuous delivery. So you make a change, maybe through a pull request in your code base, and then you, at some point when it's good, merge it to your productive branch. And then the pipeline, the Cloud SDK pipeline, did not automatically try to push that tag to your GitHub or Git repository. The Cloud SDK, the general purpose pipeline has a different default there. So, I mean, that is a matter of preference. So just if you want to restore the behavior as it was in the Cloud SDK pipeline, you can configure that here. And similar with this manual confirm step. So the Cloud SDK pipeline did not ask you for manual confirmation to deploy your application to the cloud platform, but the general purpose pipeline has a different default setting here. So, I mean, this is also, I mean, maybe this is also the right setting for you to have a manual confirmation each time, but if it is not the right default for you, then you can of course change it. So that has been a quick overview. Let's get to a short demonstration. So what I have here is an example application for Java that uses the Cloud SDK. So it's also an example that we have open sourced on GitHub. And so you can see it's a Maven project. It has a POM XML file. And what I have here open are the two files that are now relevant for what we're doing. We have a Jenkins file and we have a config file. And I can also show you the Jenkins job. So you can see here, this is a really, really minimal configuration. So it has skipped a lot of stages. This is because they are not configured. If you're looking in the configuration, you see that it really does not have much configuration in it, but for demonstration purposes, it should be good enough. So what it would do if it was configured would then run all the tests that you need, and then in the end deploy your application to the production landscape. And so what we now will do is to update this existing Cloud SDK pipeline project to general purpose pipeline, just as I described. So I do have the new Jenkins file prepared here. You see, I mean, it looks a lot shorter, but that's only because we had so many comments in the old file. So this is the new file. So it says, okay, I need this library. It's already pre-configured if you use our existing Jenkins setup script. So that is the project Piper library from github.com, and then it calls into the Piper pipeline and pass the context. And this is essentially all you need to do for this file. And then there's the config file, and there it gets a bit more complicated. So let me just quickly, for comparison reasons, introduce the new thing. So what has changed here? Essentially, so the structure of the file is still the same. So you still have a general section, a steps section, and a stages section. And so what has changed is that some steps are used a bit differently. So some steps need to be updated. And also stages, if they are configured, they have a different name. So that is all mentioned in the guide. All right. So this is my first attempt. I want to know, okay, this is now my new pipeline. So I'm doing a git commit update pipeline, git push. And this should automatically trigger a new build in our Jenkins. And let's just see. It might take a second or two. So we see we had build 23, build 24 is pending. All right, it started. So let's see what our new pipeline is doing. Let's again go into the Blue Ocean view. It's a bit nicer. Oh, it failed. Why did it fail? All right, so it tells me that my pipeline configuration contains configuration for the stage called integration. Okay, let's check the file. Stages. I see this stage integration, but it's spelled with a uppercase I. So let's see why. Why did I know? Okay, that's a bit confusing in a Jenkins user interface. Let's go back to the usual command line output. So what exactly was the error message? Contains configuration for the stage integration lowercase I. So that's weird. I should use the stage integration uppercase I. Okay, so what is wrong? If I look back, I still only see integration with uppercase I, so that is a bit weird. But it's actually a bit tricky because we have a feature that you can load external configuration from external sources. And there is our integration. So that should not have happened. But the thing is that the pipeline test is now in the beginning. So okay, in this case, I know it's easy to fix because we don't need those custom defaults. I forgot about them. Okay, can remove them. Git commit. All right, so let's try that again with this setting removed. All right, build 24 did fail, but 25 should be our friend if it's starting. Come on. All right, so what should happen now if the demo gods are good with me is that the pipeline is running through now. So what I wanted to show you is that if you have this configuration check enabled, so this legacy config setting thing, so this now made the pipeline fail in the init stage. And the idea is that it makes it fail early if you have still old configuration. So the idea is to give you a hint and not to run the full pipeline, because I mean, if you have a big project, then the pipeline might also run for some time. And the idea is to make it easy for you to get started. But of course, you can also, if you follow the guide, I mean, essentially, this is a YAML file that contains the information for what stage has been renamed into what, to automate a bit, helping you finding the right information there. But okay, so the init stage has passed, and as you might have noticed, Jenkins has now removed the existing pipeline. This is because Jenkins now realized that it's executing a different pipeline. So you can see that the general purpose pipeline works a bit differently in how it looks. So it has a pull request voting stage that is run if you're creating pull requests. So that's then running what the Cloud SDK pipeline would have run if you're pushing to a non-productive branch. And now we're in the build stage. So at this point, you can see that the pipeline is now executing a different, it's now running the different pipeline, and it should also succeed. So I'm not exactly sure how long it will take to going through successfully. And I mean, of course, this is now a really simplified example. It does not have many things configured. So if you have a production deployment configured or different things, then this might be still be required to be changed here, but it should not be too hard. So we made this guide, we tested it with quite a few projects, so that should really make it easy if you are an existing user to still keep using the pipeline that you know. And I mean, it looks a bit different now, as you can see here. And okay, now it's going through. And you can see that the promote stage is green. That was because we have made this setting to automatically promote. If you would not have set this, then here it would ask you if you want to promote, and the pipeline is true. So the stages now have different names. So the production deployment is called release. But yes, it's essentially the same thing with a different name. All right, so that's the end of what I wanted to show to you. yeah, in conclusion, I think that the continuous delivery offering that we have has improved by removing this unnecessary question of which pipeline should I use. So I would be really interested if you are an existing user, how you feel about this change. So yeah, that's don't have anything good to say right now. If you want to get in touch, feel free to reach out to the email address or also to the SAP community. There is a tag SAP Cloud SDK for everything related to the SAP Cloud SDK. So also if you might be an existing user, the pipeline, and you have questions about that, in the slides, there's also the link to the Project Piper GitHub repository. If you have specific questions about Project Piper, that is the right place to put them. And with that, I want to thank you for joining the call. And I think we still have time for questions, if there are any questions.
Yes, thank you. So feel free to use the Q&A tab or the chat if it's more convenient for you to ask questions. And if not, I would like to thank everyone for joining the call. The recording will be available in the SAP community, in the SAP community calls. So thank you very much, everyone. Have a great day.
Thank you.